now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning we'll be starting out. Some honeys will be coming along. We're loading up our woody with our boards inside and heading out singing our song.
Funnel in. Over there. Put that lower pet on there. Do not hit her with that. No. Over here, there's two over here. The gum out. Okay, everybody, deep breath. Here we are, future gardening, future gardeners of America, and all you kids, I can tell, are so excited to be here. Could you wait for me? Hey, dude, we're in there, okay? So today we are going to learn why corrugated drainage pipe is your friend. Well, yeah, Mary, this is the pipe that nasty, sludgy, stinky things go through. Yes, that's correct. Why is it shaped like your grandfather's colon? Hey, I did a colonoscopy on your grandfather. This is not shaped like his colon. He's got big diverticuli all over him, so I don't think it is. So just don't worry about it. But why is gardening pipe, drainage pipe, why is it your friend? Wait. Y'all are leaving? What do you mean you didn't have to come anyway? Ice cream in the cafeteria. Oh, God, you did it again. Undermined my whole plan. The administration just does not care about gardening. They don't care. All they're concerned about is the tests. You know. I will have my revenge. Corrugated drainage pipe will be taught in this school. It will be mandated by the school board. Okay, so now that I got that out of the way, are all the children happy? My grandkids, my two imaginary friends at home. Let's see if I've got them on monitor over here. Chicago, there he is. Peking, dude, comb your hair. Looking kind of goobery there. So all of the frivolity out of the way, I'm sure we'll have no more frivolity on this show. Why is this stuff really good for a garden? Well, I've used this probably for 30 years for different things, the most obvious of which is drainage. But when you have an area that you're wanting to control nutrients and composting delivery, as well as water, these things are excellent. And so what I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna show you how to reorient your garden around these little miracles of modern science that look like the robot arms on Smith Family Robinson's Lost in Space. And for all the young people watching, they're going, what? Or they're thinking about this series. But don't you remember? Danger, Will Robinson, danger. Danger, Will Robinson. And that really creepy, like, ne'er-do-well Dr. Smith. And I'll give you the overview, and then I will do a time-lapse cut-up, because I hate to see people do menial tasks for a long time. But this pipe we use to deliver our compost, you know, as well as water, when it's dry or when plants are needing the extra water. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to come into this thing that will go in the ground, and I'm going to drill holes all the way through here that allow for liquids to come in, go out, and worms to come in. And then I'm going to drill those holes up as deeply as I want it, as deeply as I want it in the ground. And that will be, I'm not going to tell you how far, wait, hold up, let me measure. Let me get this out and really do no measuring. Measuring is a no-no on this show. Too analytical and too specific. But depending on the ground that you're in, it'll either go low or it can go as deep as you want it to. Like in some of our beds, we're only sinking it probably 6-8 inches deep or something like that. And in some of our other beds that require like heavy water, heavy feeding, you know, we probably will dig holes up, you know, 12 inches. And then the other issue is how much above it do you leave without holes? And why do you leave without holes? Well, I mean, it's simple. If you want to water deeply, all you have to do is fill this with water with the holes at the bottom, and you customize your holes, okay? I mean, if you want a fast water watering deep, and you can put it as deep as you want it. You know, if you put it like into the really deep, like let's say 10, 12 inches down, if you put it down there, the roots are gonna seek it, you know? So it should develop, and I'm gonna study this later. This is an experiment. It in theory should stimulate some really remarkable root growth. So you dig holes as deeply as you want your nutrients to go and your water, and then you leave so much above the ground, which will make your water column, which will provide the pressure to force the nutrients and the water out of your holes that are in the ground. And once again, you can either drill a lot of smaller holes, but make sure they're large enough for earthworms to come in too, because you want the earthworms to really come in and out of those things. So I'll let you all customize that and play with that. And the height of this, except for ease, because if this is really low, it's hard to pour your nutrients into this. And when I say nutrients, I'll tell you what we do in a minute. So I'll leave that up to you too. This is what we're putting in now. I guess this is probably almost 4 feet. That may actually be a little long. So I'm gonna cut these up in a second, but the way we do our compost is when we're in the kitchen, we have scraps or whatever. We put them in our compost bin, but then we get them in a dedicated vitamin, or I think it's not something to the room, actually, 34,000 revolutions a second, and blend it into this compost soup, which we pour in here. So that's a really nice, non-messy, non-stinky, one-step way to compost all of your kitchen scraps, pretty much. I don't put the obvious stuff in, like citrus and things like that. I'm going to assume you guys probably got more composting knowledge than I do. And I say this on every show, okay? First of all, Dennis Miller principle. This is just my opinion. I could be wrong.
Of course, that's just my opinion. I could be wrong.
Second thing is, I'm not an expert. I mean, I've done this my whole life. I've like, you know, oh geez, when did I start gardening? I mean, I've been easily doing this 45, 50 years. So when you've made as many mistakes as I have, you learn some stuff. So anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and cut these things up, and you guys can watch or not watch, I'll timestamp it, and then we'll go put one in the garden and show you how it works. Nice.
Time, folks, so hurry, hurry, hurry. Step right over to our refreshment center for the most extravagant array of refreshment goodies ever assembled under one roof. Enjoy breathtaking, mouth-watering goodies, everything from a snack to a delicious full meal. At our refreshment center, you'll find a large variety of goodies to satisfy your hunger, your thirst, or your sweet tooth. So hurry, hurry, hurry. Visit our refreshment center now. The show starts in 5 minutes. The show starts in 4 minutes. The show starts in 3 minutes. The show starts in 2 minutes. The show starts in 1 minute. And now, on with the show.
I broke both the laces on both my shoes, and I just drank my last two shots of booze, and I ain't got enough money to pay my rent. Well, the federales, they took my truck, and now I'm down to my last 20 bucks, and I just can't take it anymore. Well, I know this life can get you down, down, down. So hard to get your feet on the ground, oh Lord. And I try, I try to just get by, 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 but I just can't take it anymore. Well, I met Chuck Norris in the alleyway. Well, he punched me in the face and he ran away. Picked up my dog and kicked him off a bridge. Well, I picked myself up and I kept on going, but I lost my coat and now it's snowing, and I just can't take it anymore. Well, I know this life can get you down, down, down. So hard to get your feet on the ground, oh Lord. And I try, I try to just get by, 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 but I just can't take it anymore. Well, I smoked my last bowl and now it's gone. I guess I'll have to slip the resin out from my bong and just sit my ass on the couch and just try to get high. Well, I tried to light my lighter, but it won't work. I tried to light it with my toaster, but my fingers burned, and now I just can't take it anymore. Well, I know this life can get you down, down, down. So hard to get your feet on the ground, oh Lord. And I try to just get by, 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 but I just can't take it
just can't take it anymore. Well, I know this life can get you down, down, down. So hard to get your feet on the ground, oh Lord. And I try to just get by, by, by. But I just can't take it anymore. No, I just can't take it anymore.
Got a little nutty with the Sufu crew. We had a lot of fun with you. I bell our soul, we found the beautiful sun. It's a close cause the story has just begun. It went up the Rum River, flow my river back down. Golden Bounds, Triple X campground. The rain came pouring down like a fountain. And I lost my mind upon Candy Mountain. At the Sioux Pass Ranch with the first of us pole that was made from a branch. There's poppers and ships and trips, oh my, what's happened to me?
Well, I think it was that one guy.
You only come home 3 times a year, so if you're in the job, you're gonna find us. Yeah, we got the Kush and the Diesel, Northern Lights, but nothing tastes sweeter than this Harmony Night. So, well, come on down, take a look around, slap another bag of wine. Cause the grass is greener, heavy's cleaner, and there's not a cloud in the sky. Well, come gather round and listen to the sound of 1,000 dirty bare feet hitting the ground. So everybody on the bus, we're going down to the Midwest psychedelic front porch showdown. From the North Pole, asked him for some green, but he gave me some cold. He said, well, maybe you can smoke it if you put it in your bowl. That's the last time I'll ever ride to that asshole.
Well, I got the coal if you got the bone, and if you're down with it, it's a one-hit quit.
I took one hit of coal and the room started turning. But next year I'm gonna keep the fireplace burning. I'm back to reality, we don't wear shoes. And I'm out of Mississippi in a tippy canoe. Rock the coach, you get stoned like a boulder. Rock the boat, but don't tip the boat over. If I leave right now, we can make it home, maybe. This time tomorrow, I can see my old lady. It's a beautiful day under this big blue dome. Back on the bus and take the long way home. Everybody on the bus, everybody on the bus, everybody on the bus now. Everybody on the bus, everybody on the bus. Everybody on the bus, we're going down to the Midwest psychedelic rock and roll down. Come on down, take a look around, slap another bag of wine. Cause the grass is greener, air is cleaner, and there's not a cloud in the sky. We're gonna find your place to get lost in space like a June bug in July. So everybody on the bus, we're going down to the Midwest psychedelic rock and roll showdown. We'll be right back.
Shangri-La. Give it up, yo. We love you guys. We'll see you out there.
You with irritable stomachs or irritable bowels, you may not want to watch this. I'm just joking. It's not that bad. So this is what this video is supposed to all be about. Okay, so as I said, this is what we do with pretty much all of our kitchen scraps now. And I've simplified the process. It's a little messier than this, as you might expect. But, I mean, you typically end up with some type of compost. It's normally a little chunkier. And we just put it in the, we just put it in the wearing and, you know, make sure it's liquid enough. And then turn it on. Basically deliver it into something to take it to the garden. This is always a special time of the day because after we see this hip that the squirrels gave me, but after we do our Vitamixing of the compost, then we have to get on really a much more humble, reverent attitude as we bless the compost. And you know, we've done so much work at my other job with Mexico in different regions, specifically. I'm going to hold on the ceremony. Technically, I'm not supposed to do this. The ceremony is supposed to be very much by the book, almost like the Japanese tea ceremony, which has nothing to do with this. So, since we've done so much work in the northern and middle parts of Mexico, I have to take off her hat for reverence, around the St. Louis Potipsi area, you know, the famous mining town back in the like 1500s. It was like they thought, oh, there's gonna be some silver there. Then they was like, yay, it's silver and gold and this and that. It was like crazy. But if you've ever seen the topography of that region, you understand there are canyons up there that are pretty much not accessible because of the terrain. So that's where Jalitla is. And so this ceremony goes back, you know, to the Aztec jaguar god, because the Aztecs actually came from a much earlier people, the Chichimacas. It wasn't pleasant to be called a Chichimaca back in the day, meaning like 1500s, because that basically meant uncouth barbarian. But what they had was actually a lot like the society today. They were like urban roaming groups with no real ties, that just had very matter-of-fact get the job done ways, and they got a bad rap. But we do this ceremony to honor the food back to the earth. You know, you've got, with bioenergetics, you have a lot of Eastern thought things that you don't normally have, and Western thought patterns. You know, West is all about substantial, you know, physical. The East is more about energy. So E equals MC squared. In the West, medicinally, we embrace M, mass, matter, because of pharmaceutical and chemical companies at the turn of the 18th century. That's a long story. We chose the matter way to fix things, the concept of existentialistically who we are. And in the Eastern philosophy, we're nothing more than bundles of energy, cohesive in the flow of infinite energy across all dimensions, which are 12 mathematically now. The last time I checked, I don't remember, I don't know the math. I'm just I'm parroting the people that know the math. So anyway, this is to reverence that energy back to the earth. And normally, you know, the neighborhood comes around and sits here, but I guess if you never participated in one, you don't really know what these are. So I'll kind of film this. Nobody's here tonight and Lou's working. So beautiful sunset, and we'll, most of the time we do this either just before sunrise or at the end of the day to, you know, signify the two nadirs and the energy fluxes.
Disclaimer, use of pointed objects as pointing instruments is not considered threatening or in any way meant to induce undue mental or physical harm or stress. Sorry, just had to, you have to disclaim everything these days. So if you've never seen it, this is a pretty scant, typical chichimacas. I guess in Catholic terms, it would be like a shrine, or not really a shrine because there's not really a deity per se involved. A remembrance place to pay homage to the energy of the earth. And so you have the jaguar Aztec god, as you see, with a skull coming out of him. I guess there are meanings for that. That there are a lot of different people. I know there are meanings. Many different people theorize on what the mythologic symbolism is here. That's 10 shows in and of itself, so I'm not even going to go into that. This is kind of jakey, but this is a little solar-powered light, so to provide light to the entire set of warriors, which I will show you what we do with those in a second, and this is what I'm considering my energy source, delivering photons, light energy, through my iPad with one of the Chichimacas tribal chants for health and prosperity and energy balance. And then the two salt and pepper shakers to, you know, change the flavor of the compost. And so, you know, we bring our compost in, we present it. And normally, like I say, this is done, you know, very early in the morning, probably like 4 or 5. And then we have to make sure we have the right chat volume. Before we actually start the ceremony. Where are those tribal drum guys when we need it? We have to sing. Normally Lou does this one. Oh, we went on a 2-4 rip, okay. Oh, I got the slow. And so, there it's blessed. You know, most people don't have any problem with this, but the neighbors are starting to get a little bit, I think they're wanting us to do it more at night than anything. So since this is blessed now, if the rest of the neighbors were around here, we would take, these are warriors, but it's also meant to symbolize giving the energy back, and we would take a small aliquot of this, not a whole lot, you know, about like that. Well, no, usually a little bit more because you won't have to really take it. See, and you take that, and then I would serve it to each of the guests here. See, we have a round or a semicircular thing here. But sometimes if somebody would like different seasonings, then we have the salt and the pepper just in case there's, you know, that it's not the right, but because that makes all the difference. Mine did not need it. Good. So now that that's done, and the compost has been blessed, back to the Chichimacas of St. Louis Potopsi. I always say Potipsi. Wonder what I would do with Poughkeepsie. I don't know. So once again, for you squirrel naysayers out there, yeah, you keep naysaying. So let's go finish this Totally Tubular adventure up. I think the surfers are waiting because they don't really know what they're getting into right now. But the blessed compost, I said the blessed compost will now go in the hole.
Gentlemen, today we have a real treat. We have not a single, but a double black hole elimination.
Double, I say. Double black hole.
Our three finalists will compete on the most gigantic, on the most stupendous waves ever seen in a suburban backyard. Two black holes, not just one, two black holes. We can't forget to recognize our lovely sponsor, Harvey Weinstein. Harvey's Hot Tubs.
I'm hot tubbing with Harvey.
You'll never be the same.
Papiro. Papiro. Papiro.
W dzisiejszym odcinku dowiemy się, jak zrobić papieru. Będziemy potrzebować papieru.
Mogę pani cukrzyć.
Papieru. I mnóstwa dobrej zabawy.
Telefon odbieram, cisza. Tak dniami, nocami ściemniało. Któregoś dnia w końcu telefon odbieram, cisza. Tak dniami, nocami ściemniało.
Okay, I'll stop. Anyway, I'm hot tubbing with Harvey. I'm hot tubbing with Harvey. You'll never be the same. I'm hot tubbing with Harvey. You'll never be the same. Your genitals will be gone. I told you. Anyway, cut the commercial.
And here are the three finalists. First, Yo Duke Damon. Give it up. Next, it's Surf Ninja. Get it, girl. Come on. That's it. Oh, yeah. And finally, everybody's favorite. He's small. He's funny.
The Duck.
And they're off.
Bye.
guys.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to walk down our beds, and here's some of the totally tubular things that we placed. So this is more of a ground view of it. So in this one, we have about 12 inches below, and probably, let's call it 12. So that's 2 feet. So that's a foot of hydrostatic pressure pushing things out, nutrients, water, all the things we talked about, into this area. And we're developing, and I'll show you how we use it functionally. You know, asparagus are heavy feeders, and I'm going to be doing a show specifically to show you how to integrate heavy the watering and feeding characteristics of plants and group them together along with companion planting with different kinds of herbs and flowers to retard the pests. So all of that's kind of a unit for us, but it's hard to take it all in one bite. So I'm snipping it off for you and trying to make it palatable. Yeah, real palatable. So see, there's another tube. Hence the reason for the height. These are okay. I actually think I should have made them a little higher, and I'm probably going to replace the ones in the asparagus garden because, you know, asparagus, corn. Here's our ginger that died off, so we'll come back in and get that in the spring, maybe take a little bit this fall. But you see, we have the pipes all the way down. And we center our planting around the pipe, okay? And sometimes we'll include the Three Sisters method. That's going to be another show about mounding and probably the earliest companion planting. There'll be another show on how to use trellising. You see all that down at the end. But these are all tied together. I had great tarragon this year. So there it is. Now let's see what it actually looks like. So there's what a tube in place looks like. I'm going to go ahead and install the compost for the last few days. And we mixed this a little firm. Actually, I should have mixed it up. And sometimes if you spill on the outside, that's fine. It'll just compost out here. Well, what we do is we come behind it now with a hose and just fill the tube with water. And so if you see down here, I don't know if you can see or not, but down in the tube, you see the compost there at the bottom. By tomorrow, that will probably be gone, but maybe not, because the other factor we take into account when we do this is what consistency to make the compost. So if it's a heavier consistency like that, it's going to take it a little bit longer, you know, to go into the soil and have the worms work it into the soil. So the upcoming, and that's it. If you want the cliff notes, corrugated pipe, cut it to some length, drill a few holes, and start your watering and your nutrient new way of doing things around the pipe. It's totally tubular. I think this is what I want to do is to use the next few minutes to catch up on some stuff, because most of you guys probably, I don't know whether you watch the Urban Squirrel Hunter or not. I do double duty there. So I'm like number two at the Urban Squirrel Hunters League. And, you know, I take a lot of crap for that. You know, all the stigma about being, you know, being a professional squirrel hunter and the solitude and, you know. Anyway, you've all heard the jokes, but they say we're pussies, right? Okay, so this is what happens. Actually, let's get close. This is what happens when that new strain of squirrel from the Indian and the Madagascar genetic line gets a hold of you. It started off with a hole about like that, and then the edges got necrotic, which, if you know what that means, it means it's lacking blood supply, or there's too much toxins in the area in order for the peripheral circulation to clear, and therefore tissue necrosis and all the yuck that goes with the tissue necrosis. And that's a technical term, yuck. Remember that. And so it ended up enlarging to about this. And this is the plastics closure I had 4 days ago for that. Not to mention the fact that they tore my labrum and my right hip. So I now have to have a hip replacement. So anybody that says that professional squirrel hunters are pussies, you'd better think again. At least not with this new breed of squirrel that's coming. So that's number one. Number two, this type of composting that I'm going to show you ties in with several different things that I'm going to run individual segments on. So we have a magic gel at the bottom of the tubes that I have yet to tell you about. But we will get there. That's the next installment, which you'll see at the end. A cool musical guest next time too, by the way. A really cool musical guest out of San Diego. This guy, it's called That One Guy. And if you guys have not seen him, he's the real deal. Genuine. That's it. Genuine. You know, somebody that woke up one day and didn't whine about, oh, yeah. He's like, I'm going to grab some pipe and I'm going to grab an old single string washboard bass. And I'm going to electrify it. And I'm going to make a new instrument out of it and play the shit out of it, which he does. It's pretty cool. So that's the musical guest. The gel at the bottom will be discussed in hopefully humorous and somewhat bemusing ways to all that watch. But also, when I got to looking at the compost, the other thing we can do with this, besides just pour it into the tubes, is there are a few small caveats on how you do this part of processing the compost, which is pretty much common sense. But when I was in clinic in Memphis in residency, internal medicine residency, this sweet little black lady from Memphis came in. She was nauseated, and so I gave her fenugreek suppository. You know, it's what you give. 2 days later, she comes back and she goes, "Oh, Dr. Blankenship, I know better." And I said, "What do you mean?" And she goes, "Man, that medicine leaves a metal taste in my mouth." True story, not made up. So I don't take for granted what common sense, Belfry's common sense decides to light in or not light in. So I'll tell you some stuff about the compost. But the other thing we do with this is feed our worm farm. So we have a fully functioning, small, you know, urban-sized worm farm that really kind of is compatible with this, in that as we add the nutrients in this form into the worm farm, then we get out the worm tea. And I'm going to do a separate section on this as well, after the gel probably, to tell you how wonderful, but really a little bit more scientific, biochemical, plant physiologic basis. You know, I don't know. I always need detail when people go, "Whoa, worm tea is good." Another medical story, guy brought in this huge, he said, "I'm off all my medicines, I'm doing great." And he brought in this huge mushroom that he was drinking the tea from. And now, I truly believe in natural stuff above pharmaceutical stuff, but not all of it's credible.
Mom killed chicken, tried to wash dirt, put on a table, the legs sticking up, she got to stay with them gold.
So, for the two of you that are still viewing out there, and that's only because you're at a frat party and you're too drunk to turn anything else on. Keep viewing. It's almost over. Yay, you survived. Running Man 4. So,
I'll be back.
This is going to be an interesting experiment in and of itself. Kind of a social experiment to see whether anybody is actually going to buy in to this level of integration and fact finding. We'll see. I don't know. I consider this really your station more than mine. I'm going to come up with some stuff. I've got questions I want answered. But one of my selfish reasons for wanting to do this was I love talking to people that know more than I do. Now, it's not hard. You talk to them all day, every day, don't you? What? I'm going to learn a ton from you guys. Not only from the questions, but just from what you share. You know, I plan on just doing a listener segment or whatever you call it every week. And you just going to have to take this for what it is. I'm 62 years old, you know. When I grew up, we were still using the abacus. Not far from that. Maybe abacus too. You know, had a higher microprocessor. Had slicker tines on it. You know, more grip on those little balls. Wow, man, when they came out with the rubberized ones, oh, man, you talk about speed. So, that's a perfect example. You have no idea what's going to happen. Neither do I. That's why they call it life. That's why they call it gardening. See you next time.
Just because it's cracked doesn't mean that it's broke. Just because it's a butt doesn't mean it's a joke. With a heart like an apple, but hard like a stone. Stuck in the mud because it's stuck to the bone. And this is how it starts. And this is what it seems. And this is who we are. And this is what we'll be. The future is all planned.
Anyone wishing to buy artifacts for Chichimacas ceremonial observation or other ceremonial Chichimaca artifacts, please call or contact the Mexican Consulate, 1250 23rd Street Northwest, Washington, D.C.